Hi, I'm John, and welcome to part 3 in this IT Taster video series on IP version 4 addressing. In this video, I'm going to cover IP address classes, public and private IP addressing, and how to go about choosing an IP addressing scheme for the local network. And we'll also look at some important IP addresses to be aware of. IP version 4 was originally intended to cater for approximately 4 billion devices. And despite the internet growing considerably to the point where IP version 4 addresses have been depleted, this is still an extremely large address space to manage. So the IP version 4 address space is divided into smaller, more manageable ranges. These ranges are known as IP address classes. There are a total of 5 IP version 4 address classes: Class A, Class B, Class C, Class D, and Class E. Addresses belonging to classes A, B, and C are commonly assigned to network devices. Class D and Class E addresses are used for other purposes, and I'll talk more about that later on in the video. To determine which class an IP address belongs to, we need to examine the first octet of the IP address. IP addresses that begin with 0 through to 127 belong to the class A address range. IP addresses that begin with 128 through to 191 belong to the class B address range. And IP addresses that begin with 192 through to 223 belong to the Class C address range. There's a simple technique we can use to determine the class of an IP address if we convert it to binary. All we need to do is examine the 3 high order bits in the first octet of an IP address. If the leading bit of the first octet is a 0, the address is a Class A address. If the 2 leading bits of the first octet are 10, the address is a Class B address. And if the 3 leading bits of the first octet are 110, the address is a Class C address. Now, there are 2 other address ranges to be aware of, and these are Class D and Class E address ranges. Class D addresses are reserved for multicasting. Multicasting is a technique used to send a single datagram to multiple hosts on a network. IP addresses that begin with 224 through to 239 belong to the Class D address range. Class E addresses are reserved for experimental use and won't normally be used in a production environment. Class E IP addresses begin with 240 through to 255. Now that we know what IP address classes are, let's take a closer look at the 3 most common ones: Class A, Class B, and Class C. Class A addresses were originally intended for extremely large networks. Class B addresses were intended for medium-sized networks, and Class C addresses for much smaller networks. To get an idea of the number of hosts each address class supports, we need to apply their subnet masks. Each address class has its own subnet mask, a default or natural subnet mask. The default subnet mask for a Class A network is 255.0.0.0. The default subnet mask for a Class B network is 255.255.0.0. And the default subnet mask for a Class C network is 255.255.255.0. In the previous video, we covered how to calculate the number of hosts by applying the subnet mask. And we did this by raising 2 to the power of the number of host bits, minus 2 to allow for the network address and broadcast address. So let's quickly apply this to the class A, class B and class C address ranges to determine the number of hosts per network. If we start with class A and apply the default subnet mask 255.0.0.0, 8 bits are the network ID and 24 bits are the host ID. Therefore, we need to raise 2 to the power of 24 minus 2, which gives us 16,777,214 hosts per network. Next is class B. If we apply the default subnet mask 255.255.0.0, 16 bits are the network ID and 16 bits are the host ID. Therefore, we need to raise 2 to the power of 16 minus 2, which gives us 65,534 hosts per network. And finally, class C. If we apply the default subnet mask 255.255.255.0, 24 bits are the network ID and 8 bits are the host ID. Therefore, we need to raise 2 to the power of 8 minus 2, which equals 254 hosts per network. This gives us an idea of the number of hosts per network each address class supports. If we take a look at the Class A address range again, we can see it caters for over 16 million hosts per network. In reality, we would never have 16 million hosts on a single segment because the network simply wouldn't function. The number of hosts per network is so large because of the default subnet mask for the Class A address range. It's important to note that when IP addresses are combined with their default subnet masks, they're known as classful addresses. However, IT professionals are able to divide address spaces into smaller networks, and this is done by altering the subnet mask. Addresses that do not have their default subnet mask applied to them are known as classless addresses. Now, there are some important IP addresses we need to be aware of within the class ranges. The class A address 0.0.0.0 is used to specify the default route, where to send packets when no route is specified. 127.0.0.1 is reserved for loopback, and this is known as the loopback address. In fact, the whole 127 range is reserved for loopback, and it's most commonly used as a diagnostics tool to determine whether IP is working correctly on the local machine. I'm going to ping the loopback address 127.0.0.1, and we receive a reply which tells us IP is working correctly on this machine. Now, notice what happens if I ping 127.0.0.2. Again, we receive a reply, and this is because the whole 127 range is reserved for loopback. The class B address range 169.254.0.0 is reserved for Automatic Private IP Address Assignment, APIPA, or sometimes called APIPA. APIPA is intended to provide a failsafe when client devices configured to use DHCP are unable to obtain an IP address from a DHCP server. Client devices that are unable to obtain an IP address from a DHCP server automatically configure themselves with an IP address from this range. Okay, I've disconnected the DHCP server and I've also released my IP address so that we can take a look at APIPA in action. If I run ipconfig, notice I have an automatically configured IP address, an APIPA address, which is 169.254.241.112. And I have a default class B subnet mask. So if you notice the first two octets of a device IP address beginning with 169.254, it's an indication there's a problem with the connection to the DHCP server, or there's a problem with the DHCP server itself. As well as IP address classes, there are two IP address types to be aware of: public IP addresses and private IP addresses. And knowing the difference between the two is extremely important. Let's start with public IP addresses. Public IP addresses are globally unique and assigned to internet devices directly connected to the internet. And they're globally managed by the Internet Assigned Numbers Authority. Organizations and users like us are issued public IP addresses by an internet service provider. Larger organizations typically purchase a number of public IP addresses for their internet-facing devices, such as web servers, email servers, and firewalls, to name a few. As home users, our routers are typically assigned a temporary public IP address from an ISP, which is carefully managed. So where do we obtain IP addresses to assign to our internal networks? Well, this is where private IP addresses come in. Private IP addresses are ranges of IP addresses reserved for internal networks only. We encounter them in most organizations and home networks too. Unlike a public IP address, private IP addresses are not allocated to a specific organization, and they are not routable over the internet. So how do we go about choosing a private IP addressing scheme for our local networks? Well, there are three private address ranges reserved for internal networks, as specified in RFC 1918, one for each class range. Once we know the number of hosts required, not forgetting to allow some scope for future expansion, we simply need to choose a private address range that best suits our requirements. The Class A private address range is 10.0.0.0 to 10.255.255.255, with the default 8-bit subnet mask and 24 host bits. The Class A private address range gives us 16,777,214 hosts. The Class B private address range is 172.16.0.0 to 172.31.255.255. With a 12-bit subnet mask and 20 host bits, the Class B private address range gives us 1,048,574 hosts. And the Class C private address range is 192.168.0.0 to 192.168.255.255. With a 16-bit subnet mask and 16 host bits, the Class C private address range gives us 65,534 hosts. Now you'll notice that the subnet masks for the Class B and Class C private address ranges are not the default subnet masks for these classes. And this is because of something called classless interdomain routing, or CIDR for short. CIDR was developed to enable address spaces to be used more efficiently and help slow the depletion of IP version 4 addresses. CIDR moves away from the traditional classful addressing and allows addresses to be written in a compact way by specifying the IP address followed by the network prefix, the subnet mask, which is written using slash notation, for example 192.168.0.8/16. When an IP address and network prefix are abbreviated in this way, it's referred to as CIDR notation. When examining public and private IP addresses, there's an important technology that sits in between the two, and that's Network Address Translation, or NAT. Private IP addresses can only be used for internal networks, and they're not valid on the internet. And public IP addresses are in short supply. This creates a problem when we want our internal devices to access the internet. Fortunately, network address translation solves the problem. NAT translates a private IP address, or addresses depending on the type of NAT used, into a public IP address which can then be routed on the internet. This means only a small number of public IP addresses are needed for internet facing devices. But we still have considerable scope for local network devices by utilizing the private IP address space. Well, that brings us to the end of this video, and I hope you found it helpful. In the next video in the series, we'll take a look at how to divide an address space into smaller networks by examining subnetting. Don't forget to subscribe to the IT Taster channel if you haven't already. Your comments are welcome, and thanks for watching.